Welcome to the Leadership Lounge, a place to kick back and listen as our experts dissect some of the biggest questions leaders face today. I'm Emma Coombe, Leadership Advisor in our London office. And in today's episode, we're talking about how leaders can recognize and confront burnout in themselves and in their teams. No one's immune from experiencing burnout, not even accomplished leaders. And in fact, what we see is that it's often the most high-performing leaders who push themselves the hardest and the furthest who are the most at risk from burnout. It's something that's not talked about nearly enough. In organizations, we don't think twice about discussing and supporting each other when there's a physical sickness. Yet when it comes to discussing mental health and topics like this, like burnout, leaders can be much more guarded. So what can we do to address this growing problem? What are the warning signs of burnout? And when a leader reaches burnout, what are the consequences for the individual and the organization? But before we dive in, we'd like to remind our listeners that you can find all episodes of Leadership Lounge and Redefiners on YouTube. If you're watching this video, hit subscribe now. And don't forget to share any burning questions you want our experts to answer by emailing redefiners@russellreynolds.com. We look forward to hearing from you. First up, we'd like to welcome Guylaine David, Leadership Advisor from Russell Reynolds Associates Paris office. Guylaine, welcome to the lounge.
Thank you. Very happy to be here.
Guylaine, burnout can mean different things to different people. How would you define burnout and how does it impact organizations today?
Well, burnout is defined by the World Health Organization since 2019 as chronic workplace stress that has not been effectively managed. And basically, it's defined by three dimensions. First, feelings of energy depletion or exhaustion. Second, increased mental distance from one's job or feelings of negativism or cynicism related to the job. And third, reduced professional efficacy.
Yeah, I think that, Guylaine, is what's particularly interesting about this definition by the World Health Organization, that burnout is described explicitly as workplace stress, and therefore the onus is on organizations and their leaders to take responsibility and address the issue. We'd now like to welcome Nic Cutts into the conversation. Nic is a leadership advisor in Russell Reynolds Associates Dubai office and has two decades of experience counseling leaders from some of the largest firms in the world on how to successfully lead a team and model the right behaviors. So we're excited to speak to him on this topic. Nic, welcome to the Leadership Lounge.
Thanks, Emma. It's great to be here.
Nic, when I was thinking about the topic of burnout for this episode, a memorable story from one of our early seasons of Redefiners sprung to mind. It was a conversation with Anastina Hintzer, CEO of Hintzer Performance. And in the episode, there was a story that caught all of our breath. She shared that one morning she was running down the stairs to catch a taxi and she fainted. When she woke up at the bottom of the stairs, her first instinct was to go and grab her laptop. And in that moment, she knew that she had burnt out. And we all know burnout can affect different people in different ways. But for me, when this lack of proportionality comes between work and everything else in our lives, it's a real sign that something's gone very wrong. But for you, Nic, what are the common warning signs of burnout? And do they present differently for senior leaders and employees?
Look, the fact is, regardless of who you are, that when you're under too much stress, you're not at your best. A key component of our assessment approach at Russell Reynolds is to measure and help manage the counterproductive work behaviors that can emerge when we're under stress. Our assessment techniques incorporate a psychometric measure of these behaviors, which, depending upon your personality, can incorporate themes like micromanagement, losing your temper, impulsive behavior, taking risky decisions, withdrawal from other people, attention-seeking behavior, and people-pleasing. People are different, and I would encourage everyone to become familiar with their own derailers when they face stress and keep a watchful eye on them when they emerge. These behaviors are rarely conscious choices, and we become aware of them when we reflect back. So reflect often and keep an eye on yourself. This goes for senior leaders and employees alike.
I think that's a really interesting point, Nic, and everybody should be aware of how they behave under pressure and critically the impact that could have on other people. But I do think it's really important to make the distinction between working under pressure and experiencing stress. In my mind, being stressed can be normally quite easily resolved. You can go for a run, you can catch up with a friend. Burnout, for me, is when things have really gone a step further and someone experiences a complete loss of ability to self-regulate and to keep things in perspective. You're also right when you say that burnout isn't reserved for leaders or those in positions of power. But I do think, and the research shows, that those who are high performers are often the ones at the highest risk of burnout. High performers are blessed with being able to push a little bit longer and a little bit harder, but it's difficult to know where to draw the line. We'd now like to welcome Henryk Krajewski, leadership advisor at Russell Reynolds Associates Toronto office, to share his perspectives on this topic. Henryk, welcome to the Leadership Lounge.
Pleasure to be here. Thank you.
We know that many leaders at the top of organizations are feeling burnt out. Our research showed that 37% of CEOs who left their role in 2021 left to prioritize their physical and emotional well-being, and a further 20% of leaders left for the same reason. Now, no doubt that number is slightly inflated because of all of the pressures of the pandemic, but nevertheless, it is a really alarmingly high number. Prioritizing well-being isn't just important for a leader personally, it's also, of course, a strategic imperative for organizational success. So what are the consequences when a leader reaches burnout?
Well, I think there are two aspects that I think about in terms of consequence. The first is C-suite retention. I've presided over three cases in the last 6 months alone where CEOs have left their organization either to retire early or to move to what they perceive as a better working environment, all due to losing some sort of enthusiasm over their work. The second consequence arises when a CEO stays through the burnout period. In that case, they can really wear the effects of burnout. For my CEO clients, this shows up in terms of depersonalization. So frustration grows, charismatic leadership goes down, patience goes down, recognition falls off. As one CEO put it, "I don't know why I seem to be jumping down people's throats lately." As that example implies, most of the time we're not even aware of what's happening and why we're at the end of our collective ropes. And this can dramatically affect the culture and performance of the leadership team and organization.
Undoubtedly, burnout can also have a negative impact on the bottom line. In fact, research from AXA UK and the Centre of Economic and Business Research in 2023 uncovered that work-related stress and burnout is costing the UK economy £28 billion a year and resulting in over 23 million sick days annually. Successful organizations will be the ones who take this matter seriously. There are positive steps being taken, however. For example, in the UK, we have a fabulous initiative called the Mindful Business Charter. Many professional services, financial services organizations have signed up to this initiative, and it's all about being open about more respectful ways of working. It's built on four key pillars: openness and respect to build trust, smart communications, so avoiding requesting for a huge amount of work to be done from a Friday night with a deadline of a Monday morning when the timelines could have been managed so much better, respecting rest periods and covering for each other when away on holiday, and mindful delegation. It really encourages people to be more thoughtful about the impact that they have on others. I'd like to now shift the conversation a little and talk about the importance of acknowledging burnout. For leaders, admitting to experiencing burnout can feel like failure. But how important is it that leaders reframe this moment for themselves and others?
That's a very important question because admitting to feeling burnout is not always easy, but it should not be seen as a sign of weakness or poor performance. In fact, it's often the opposite. Many leaders who experience burnout will try to keep going, often using brute force to continue performing because they may have convinced themselves that it's just a spike in volume and that things will regulate sooner or later. And for those leaders, they are likely to work extremely long hours and miss social events to get things done. This might be okay in the short term, but continuing to push through can be damaging and contribute to make the situation even worse. There's still a stigma wrongfully attached to admitting to experiencing burnout, but there is a strength in acknowledging it, understanding the root cause, and taking steps to manage it.
So I think one key way to remove that stigma is to talk openly and honestly about the topic. So I'm really glad we're having this conversation today. And we are seeing a shift in the public eye with many prominent leaders talking about burnout. Back in 2011, during the financial crisis, Antonio Horta Azario, at the time Group CEO of Lloyds Bank, a major financial institution, took 8 weeks off work after experiencing extreme exhaustion. And New Zealand's former Prime Minister, Jacinda Ardern, is another example. She admitted that she didn't have enough in the tank to continue in her role. But as we discussed earlier in the episode, it's not just senior leaders who experience burnout. Our research in 2022 found that 35% of employees had difficulty maintaining a healthy work-life balance with their current employer, and 40% said they were finding it tough to compete in their industry without risking unhealthy levels of stress. So what are the steps you can take as a leader to create a culture that promotes employee well-being? And what is the impact if you don't?
So look, burnout occurs at least in part as a result of the culture that we as leaders drive and propagate. Cultures of long hours, working weekends, being available while on leave. We all have to make these concessions occasionally, but when the exception becomes the habit, this is where the risk occurs. I work with a COO of a global company who traveled so much and so frequently that he collapsed on a flight and had to be taken to hospital. In the next coaching session, all he could speak about were the meetings that he missed and what others would think about him. He was stressed out about being stressed out. So taking breaks and ensuring that your workload is manageable isn't desirable, it's necessary. I often speak to employees who feel obligated to work long hours because their bosses do. Some leaders inadvertently role model overly heroic, hardworking behaviors with good intentions, but fewer actively role model looking after yourself and showing vulnerability. I think we can all do more of this.
I think it's such an important point, Nick. And I've been reading over the past few days, Dr. Ty Wiggins, my colleague's book entitled The New CEO. And he shares an anecdote about coaching a CEO who was seen by her organization to almost walk on water because she maintained this fabulous work-life balance and yet was constantly emailing at the weekends. And in fact, what was happening is that the appointments that she was blocking out to allow her to maintain that balance, for example, attending a son's critical college graduation, was always marked private in her calendar, and people couldn't really get their heads around what was going on. But actually, by unlocking that, by being more honest about why certain bits of times were blocked out and why she then needed to compensate at the weekend, meant that others could understand her different work pattern, respect it, but not feel that they had to emulate something extraordinary to be as successful as she was. Henryk, I know you wanted to chime in on this point. What, in your experience, can leaders do to avoid a burnout culture?
The most important step is to role model the behaviors you want to see in your employees. In particular, I encourage my CEO clients to talk about burnout and well-being openly, even sharing their own experiences on where they've felt overworked or undermotivated and what they did to combat it. Leaders worry that this makes it okay to underperform and complain about work. After all, isn't work all about running through walls no matter what? But quite the contrary. By sharing what I call self-disclosures, CEOs can build a culture of openness and safety, encouraging their team to have actual human reactions to different phases of the work year and seek support where needed. As a final note, I'd add, if you fail to create an environment where employees feel well-being is prioritized, don't be surprised when your employees find an organization and a leader that does.
Exactly that. And I think in many organizations, employees are not encouraged to share issues they're facing, as we've been discussing. Instead, there's a culture that can be described as toxic positivity, where employees feel they must always be enthusiastic and upbeat about their work. This can be particularly dangerous and lead to the worst cases of burnout, as there's often fear associated with sharing negative thoughts. So in organizations, if people are managing very high workloads, rather than simply celebrating it, but actually talking to that individual about how they're coping, how they're finding it, I think with new joiners is a really sensitive time as well. Being more thoughtful around when individuals could be struggling, but maybe not talking about it openly, is very important. Now, we know that prevention is better than cure when it comes to leadership burnout. But if a leader is experiencing burnout, what strategies, Henryk, can be used to ease it?
In my CEO coaching practice, I see two main solutions. One is improving delegation skills. Now, delegation sounds tactical and even trite, but it's a very strategic activity. It's not easy to meaningfully delegate important matters. CEOs are used to having things done their way, and their way has been a key source of their success. But at that level, you can't solve every problem yourself. Delegation not only lightens the load, but it also empowers the team by showing trust in their capabilities. And it can provide the CEO with the breathing space they need to recover. A second solution, and most fundamental and most overlooked, is maintaining healthy habits. Self-care isn't selfish, it's essential. We maintain every machine around us, except often ourselves. So prioritize things that are important to your well-being. such as exercise, nutrition, and sleep. They can help you maintain your energy and focus, all of which are vital for effective leadership.
Henryk, you're right, because sleep is so incredibly important and undervalued. Research by the journal Sleep, in fact, found that someone who sleeps 6 hours each night for nearly 2 weeks had the same mental faculties as someone who had not slept at all for one night. A consistent lack of sleep can really hamper your cognitive abilities. And for me, I think the really important part of self-care that we mustn't forget is being open with others, whether that's in the workplace or with those around you in your private life, sharing honestly how you're feeling, what's difficult, where you're struggling, so that it doesn't all build up and then potentially lead to a burnout. And your point about delegating is key. None of us are superheroes, not even CEOs. It's important to delegate, to show you have trust in your team and to seek support when needed. So our time in the lounge today has come to an end. In 30 seconds, this is what we learned. Certain work behaviors can serve as useful indicators that you're under stress or exhibiting the early signs of burnout. Learn to recognize the behaviors you show under stress to stop burnout in its tracks. There are two key consequences of burnout for organizations: an increase in turnover as leaders leave to find organizations that prioritize well-being, or a leader staying and wearing the effects of the burnout and negatively impacting the culture around them. The most successful leaders are those who can role model resilience and vulnerability. And to avoid burnout, improve your ability to delegate and prioritize self-care. Thank you to all of our guests for joining me today. If you have any topics or burning questions you'd like us to cover in future episodes of Leadership Lounge, then get in touch. Email your questions to rediners@russellreynolds.com. You can find us on LinkedIn and follow us on X at RRA on Leadership. You can also find us on Instagram at Rediners Podcast, and you can also now subscribe to our YouTube channel. Until next time, goodbye.